Ladies and gentlemen, tonight we have the United States Senator from the great state of Oregon, Mr. Jeff Merkley, ladies and gentlemen. Senator Merkley's in the house. Not only that, we have mayoral candidate and drummer Bim Ditson in the house tonight. Like saying his name. We've got comedian Robbie Pankow. Put your hands together for Robbie. An incredible musical guest. We've got the Minders. Give it up for the Minders. We've got a hot political debate, jokes from our writing staff, and tunes from our house DJ, Bobby D from X-Ray FM, and so much more. Turn it up, Bobby D. Let's welcome our host, Alex Falcone.
Hey, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out. Hand for Bree for doing that very brief warm-up. I just noticed that brief has your name in it. Okay. Having trouble focusing today. Thank you guys for not sitting here. I really do appreciate it. We save these seats for visiting dignitaries, kings, political figures of any kind. Really, it's very important that you keep them empty. It's very good. The balcony is full because everyone wanted to be as far away from me as physically possible. I appreciate that. We have such a fun show. As Bree mentioned, it's going to be a little political in here. A little different from some of your other political shows you may have seen, but maybe more political than she gave it credit for. But first, we'd like to start out with a little bit of local news. First up, my favorite story of the week, I think the city council voted preemptively to ban weed drive-thrus. Nobody had applied. It was actually kind of cool that they thought of that so that they could ban it. But even though it's illegal, it's important to remember that you can still buy weed from your friend Scott who works at a drive-thru. That's still totally fine. I'm not a huge pot smoker, but I still am like frustrated when the city bans something as creative and clearly irresponsible as a weed drive-thru. Because if that doesn't work, then this city is never going to embrace my idea of an ice cream sensory deprivation tank. Think about it. What if all your senses were ice cream? Think about it. Don't think about it too hard. Oregon unemployment hit its lowest level since 2007. It's very exciting. One of the things I was reading, though, surprised me, is that one of the things that people say is one of the reasons why our unemployment is so low is because we've been attracting a lot of big companies here, and which means that transplants are kind of helping, which is weird. I know. And one of my good friends, Bree Pruitt, is born here, has been talking a lot of shit on the transplants. Bree, do you have anything you want to say?
No.
Bree, if you want to do panel, you have to apologize. Say it.
Thank you, transplant.
I can't hear you.
Thank you, transplant.
Well, I don't think they can hear in the balcony where most of the people are sitting. They could have heard you here, but they're not here. All the way for the balcony, Bree.
All right, thanks, transplants. Thank you for moving here and bringing money and jobs.
Give her a hand. That's very brave. That's very brave of her. A 6-year-old from Roseburg, Oregon, was uninjured after she climbed into one of those claw machines and got stuck. Paramedics say they're going to get her out as soon as mom will give them more quarters. A massive fire last week at the Portland Sundance Marina damaged hundreds of yachts. And, yeah, look, I know you don't want to feel bad, but it really was a devastating fire with horrible repercussions. How are these people supposed to get to their islands? What, you think they're going to take their backup yachts? There's no way. Those are backup yachts for a reason. They're out of style. I know it sounds harsh, but I don't even have a land vessel, so I just can't. I can't bring myself to feel bad for them. The new Selwood Bridge is open, for those of you with land vessels. Yeah. I'm surprised how excited everybody is. You guys seem really excited about it. The hype for this thing was crazy. It was like an iPhone launching. There were people, I don't know if you saw this, camping out under the bridge for a chance to drive over it. Thank you guys for sitting up front. I won't hurt you. Now that the new bridge is open, they're actually going to take the old Selwood Bridge, and they're going to—it's going to have to be properly disposed of. So they're going to take it apart and then just throw it on the corner with all the Christmas trees. Hopefully, someone will find it. They said they were going to recycle it, but like, what bin? I don't even know. I can pick a bin. Salem, the city of Salem, announced they're not going to re-up their contract to clean out weeds from city parks. They had hired a company full of goats. I don't know if you guys heard that story last year. They're not going to re-up their contract with the goats because... Was somebody like on a cruise ship hypnotist show recently? How does you just say goats and somebody...
We got one of the union reps here.
Look, I'm sorry about the loss of jobs, goats. This is what the city said. They were like, they're not going to rehire them because the goats, quote, smell bad. Huge surprise. Also, good luck getting rid of them, Salem. Like, if you think you could just take somebody who doesn't have a job and eats weeds all day, you can't. I have a guy living on my couch for 6 months. You can't just get rid of these people. I just want to say, though, if you are a goat and you're recently unemployed, don't feel bad. You know, just they say you can't be a gardener, but you can be anything you want to be in Walt Disney's Zootopia, now in theaters. I don't know why Disney sponsored that one joke, but they did. It was nice. Zootopia, welcome to the urban jungle. The Portland Art Museum, more animal news, the Portland Art Museum has been hosting every month, or every week, they're hosting special Catter Day events. Have you guys gone?
Yes.
Was it great?
Cat rapper? Available as musical guest, I'm sure.
We'll get him.
We have mixed feelings about the cat rapper that I will not share with you right now. He's in a beef with this dog rapper we hired. It doesn't matter.
Pitbull.
Nice. Not on the cart. That one just happened. Anyway, so they're holding these events because they have the quote, world's best cat painting on display at the art museum. And obviously we were thinking about the story, and one of our writers, the great Stephen Wilbur, who now lives in Los Angeles, but he Skypes in and writes with us, he really wanted to read a lot of artist names that are also cat puns. And that's not, I just don't want you guys to think that's the kind of show that we are, but it was his dying wish. And he's been leaving me voicemails all week. I think, Boone, do you have some of the voicemails? Can you play a voicemail of Stephen Wilbur from Los Angeles?
Hey, Alex. It's me, staff writer and Portland's funniest person 2014, Stephen Wilbur. It's about 3:30. On March 8th, and I was just calling because I had some cat painter ideas for that joke you begged me to write. Here we go. Meowkelangelo, of course. Pablo Picasso. Claude Monet. Leonardo da Vinci. And Scratchin' Pollock. Scratchin' Pollock. Well, anyways, that's all I got right now. I'll call you back if I got more. Talk to you later. Hey, Alex. Stephen Wilbur again. It's about 5:15 on March 9th. I had some more cat painter ideas. Georgia O'Teeth. Cat has teeth. Manxy. Modern spin on things.
Pretty modern.
Roy Lichtenstein.
Okay.
Cats are known for licking. And Hitchin. Hitchin. Anyways, I'll talk to you later. Bye.
Yeah. I'm sorry about this.
It's 4 in the morning. March 10th, I just woke up and I had an idea for a cat painter. Salvador Dali. I'm going back to bed. Have a good night. Hey, Alex, about 8:30 in the morning on March 10th, I realized last night I called you and said, gave you the idea of Salvador Collie, but collies are dogs, so please disregard that one. Frida Calico. Say hi to your wife for me.
Stephen Wilmer, everybody. It means a lot that you do that. It was his dying wish, and he's going to watch the tape, so I really appreciate you guys laughing, even though you hated it. That was very kind of you. He's not sick, by the way. He's just, we're all dying, is what he said, and he just wanted to get his wish out of the way early. The worst would be...
His only one. That's
yeah, you only get the one, and he'd use it up. Like, obviously, you wouldn't want to, like, die without using your dying wish, so he was getting it ahead of time. Anyway, that was Steven. Let's keep going with the monologue. It was a long week for me. All right, mayoral candidate Ted Wheeler's plan to tackle Portland's growing homelessness problem included statements that were plagiarized from rival candidate Jules Bailey's website. That happened. And I just want you to know, like, especially we here at Late Night Action, we find this appalling. Like, as professional writers, we think that if you're the kind of person who would steal someone else's words and ideas and present them as your own, well, then you might be a redneck. Because that is just... okay, a Portland man has officially registered the new political action committee, the Trump Has Tiny Hands Pack. And I, like, we were talking about this a lot, and I know, like, there are worse problems with Trump, like, being a racist, but I like this one because this is the one he hates. Like, you call him a racist, he doesn't care. You say he has tiny hands, and he's like, his head explodes. It's great. And I also like, you know, like, as a, I'm not that smart, and I like comedy, so I would way rather talk about their physical appearance if that's what this election can come down to. I'm going to start a series of my own packs, including the Ted Cruz looks like a character in a Disney movie played by a weasel pack. Bernie Sanders looks like an off-duty wizard pack. Marco Rubio's forehead is so big it looks like only the top half of his face was allergic to bees pack. And of course, the Hillary Clinton looks very presidential pack. It's really amazing. She just fits that office. I don't know. One more cat story I gotta do. Did you guys see there's a new cat hotel, a deluxe cat hotel opening up right next to the cat cafe? It's called Pounce Play and Stay. And according to the company's website, this is 100% true, Pounce will offer its feline clients toys, heated beds, custom scratching structures, and music created specifically for cats. Now look, Steven also thought we should say that they also had some dirty movies available in the hotel. And you already used your dying wish, is what I said. There's no...
Hey, Alex. It's Steven Wilbur. I've got some of those cat porno titles you offered me $50 to write.
I did not.
Here we go. Backdoor Scratcher 7. Nine Lives, One Cup. Pussy Petters. Rough Tongues Dripping with Cream. And Newly Two and Ready to Screw. That's all I got. I'll talk to you later. Say hi to your wife for me.
I don't know, it's weird. He also really wanted me to tell you that those are available on Paw Per View. So that's just what Steven wanted. He's very sick. Let's end it there. I have so many more. We're running out of time. We gotta keep moving. That's the monologue, everybody. Steven Wilbur by phone.
LA has not been good for that guy.
He is the same. But now he has to call me. Normally he would have just showed up at my house and told me those jokes. Now, it's weird. I said we're running out of time, which is weird, 10 minutes into a show. But, as you know, this may come as a surprise to you. It surprised me a little bit. It turns out senators have tight schedules. And so we kind of had to work around him instead of doing it at our leisurely pace. So shall we just get going? You guys ready? Please welcome out Democratic Senator from the state of Oregon. It's Mr. Jeff Merkley.
Thank you.
They love you, Jeff. Listen to that.
Love them.
Yeah.
Hey, Oregon.
Wow. So thank you so much for coming. How are you doing? How is being home? How's your break?
I'm doing well. I'm just enough time to come home, catch a few more colds, fly back to D.C.
Are you? how does D.C. treat you? Because you were in the state senate here for a while, and now you're out in D.C. doing the Lord's work. What is it like?
What I expected is when I went back to D.C., I thought it would be like going from the minor leagues to the major leagues.
Yeah.
But the thing is, it turns out that the Oregon State Legislature is so competent and functional compared to the U.S. Senate, it's almost the reverse.
You feel like you're playing in the minor leagues now?
I feel like that obviously it's a big stage, does really important stuff, but mostly it's dysfunctional, it's broken, it's paralyzed. It's nothing like the Senate I first knew when I was an intern back in the 70s or working for Congress in the 80s.
And you have a master's in public policy, you're a policy guy, so presumably getting to a place where you don't even actually get to debate the policies must be very frustrating.
Well, I try to keep coming the foundation, good policy, and let things go from there in whatever battle that takes you into.
When you come home then, do you come home like energized to get back at it, or are you like wiped out when you're done with a session?
So they only really operate in D.C. from Monday night through Thursday night, and I fly home on Thursday night. By Thursday night, I've worked day and night through those 3 days. I'm completely exhausted. I'm fractured. The flight home feels like it takes forever, and then I re-energize over the weekend to go back into battle.
And since I mentioned you're a policy guy, I just want to talk about some policies from you. I want to talk. We've done this with other figures before, and I want to know. I want you to tell us the three things that you care about that we don't care enough about. You don't think people are paying enough attention to, either here or nationally.
Oh, great. I love that. Well, let me just start with the phrase, keep it in the ground. Anybody know what keep in the ground? Have you heard keep in the ground?
That is similar to advice my dad gave me. But I think a little different. What does this mean to you, Senator?
Very good. Well, this really is about saving our planet. You know, back to the policy side, if we are going to save our planet, we've got to keep 80% of all the proven fossil fuel reserves in the world in the ground, and that means that we should start with what you and I own, what all of us own. We own, as citizens, we are co-owners of a whole lot of gas and coal and oil, and those should be managed for the public good. And the public good is to keep them in the ground and not burn them and save our planet.
I feel like I just found out.
Thank you.
I understand why you're clapping, but I just found out I own oil and now I can't sell it. I'm a little disappointed. I assume the people who actually make money off the oil are also going to be disappointed by that strategy.
Well, you think about it this way. If we can't keep our oil in the ground, how are we going to compel everyone else who has to keep their oil in the ground? And it's a very short window to do this. We are right here in Oregon. We have all these effects from global warming. We have the pine beetle, which is not dying during the winter. And our oysters have to be changed. We have to change the pH of the acidity of the water artificially so they can form shells. It's crazy. And so this is the last generation that can really do something about it in a major way, and it's coming so fast, and so we've got to act fast.
So maybe I'm more cynical than you, but I hear that about the oysters and the pine beetle, and I feel like maybe these are canaries in a coal mine, and maybe it's too late. Maybe it's like burn it if you got it time. Maybe, like, do you still think that if we stop burning, like, we're actually going to do, like, or is climate change too far gone for us?
It's a whole progression, but if we can keep 80% in the ground, then we can keep the temperature of the planet from going up by more than 2 degrees centigrade. And just that's almost 4 degrees Fahrenheit. The further it goes and the more acidity you have in the water, the worse it gets. And when you think about that kind of question, you have it, well, let's just enjoy the party now.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know what our kids and grandkids are going to say if we party and destroy the planet.
I feel like I took care of myself. I feel like it's like the people who are against the inheritance tax. Like, let's not leave them a world. You make your own world, right? Nobody's with me. Okay. So we keep 80% in the ground. This is something that we're going to do legislatively. We're going to limit the amount of pumping we're able to do.
So when I put forward this idea legislatively a year ago, people said, you're really crazy. No more leases. And what about the income that comes to the federal government? Well, since then, We have turned down the pipeline for that tar sands of Canada, and that's a huge win not to turn on the faucet. I had a bill on no drilling in the Arctic, and that's part of keeping the ground. And since then, Shell, and by the way, the protesters in Oregon were awesome in helping out with this. Shell decided not to drill in the Arctic, and no more leases there. And now we were lobbying the president, and he has shut down any new coal leases. So three big victories in what seemed a year ago like an impossible idea.
When you're in, this is a very welcoming crowd for your ideas. I wonder if the Senate is also this excited when you propose something like that.
Yeah, the Senate is not so excited because here's a big problem, is that the Senate is now controlled by the Koch brothers. I walked into the restroom last week and I heard two Republican senators saying, well, we got the word from the Koch brothers. Now we have to take X position on the presidential, which was the
not that clear. Bill.
And I'm like, really? That's what the U.S. Senate is going to do. But think what happened in 2014 when I last run. The Koch brothers came into our state. They spent probably around $5 million promoting my opponent because she signed on to their fossil fuel burning agenda. And I must say, I put up ads after Labor Day attacking the Koch brothers, saying he's out-of-state oil and coal billionaires. And their campaign collapsed so fast. Thank you, Oregon, for driving the Koch brothers out of our state.
Bree, you got really excited when you said, I was in the men's restroom at the Senate.
Well, this is the kind of house of cards dirt we wanted in this political episode. Bathroom stuff. It's conspiratorial and the men's room, and that's why we need more women in politics, because it's separate.
Right, they're,
it's a separate meeting.
Although it also makes me think we should have more political journalists hanging out in men's rooms, because this is where you hear the stuff.
Well, that's the best stuff I've ever heard there, actually. So.
Okay. What's number two on your thing that we should care more about?
Well, the Supreme Court. Supreme Court right now, it has become the most politicized instrument. My Republican colleagues are trying to pack the court by taking away the power of this president to do what he's supposed to do and what we're supposed to do, which is give advice and consent. And it's really outrageous. The Supreme Court makes so many key decisions. For example, the reason the Koch brothers could do what they did was Citizens United decision.
Right.
The total opposite of what Jefferson laid out as a vision of this country, where citizens have an equal voice. Instead, we now have a public commons that costs a lot of money, and allowing the concentrated power of corporations to act as if they're a person and spend unlimited sums is a complete corruption of our democracy, and it's the Supreme Court that makes that call. And we need to have this president's nominee heard before the Senate, debated before the Senate, and hopefully confirmed by the Senate.
So, yeah, I think we agree with that. But you're a practical man. You understand how things work. What would you put, if you were betting, what would be the odds of that actually happening?
Well, it's not great odds. But it's possible. I mean, let's see what the...
Yeah, I'd love... Tell me the way that it's possible. I'd love to hear that.
Okay, the road path is this. The president puts forward a nominee. That nominee has ties to key demographic groups in this country. And suddenly you have the Republican candidate saying, well, we need that group to support us, and we are not going to treat that person in a way that's never been done before. I mean, we always give a fair hearing. The Senate, when the Democrats are in charge, they gave fair hearing election year to Republican nominees, vice versa. It's been 12 times. This idea that suddenly a president is elected for 4 years but only carries constitutional powers for 3 years, no. It wasn't, yeah, I looked in the Constitution, I looked it up, and it wasn't there. It didn't say year four, it stops. Sorry.
Well, but you know, everybody slides senior year. Yeah, like, the president is taking tennis lessons and just working on his thesis at this point.
Well, this is a piece, whatever else slides, this one shouldn't.
Okay.
This is too important.
And number three, what's the third one on your mind?
Well, the third is really a battle that's coming up this week, and I don't know if it'd always be third on my list, but I'm going to talk about it now because Monsanto is trying to jam through.
Big fans of Monsanto in the house.
I don't think they're clapping for Monsanto. I don't think so.
You don't think?
No. Here's here's what's happening. In July 1st, a law goes into effect in Vermont, in which Vermont said, we want to put on the label information about whether there are GMO, genetically engineered ingredients, in the food. And so Monsanto says, we have to stop that. We do not want states giving information on genetic engineering to their citizens, even if their citizens really want it. So they are trying to ban states from acting. It's called the DARK Act, or I call it the DARK Act. Many people do. Deny Americans the Right to Know. It's not the official name, but
oh, that's a pretty good acronym, though.
Let's make it stick.
Yeah.
Right? And so I fought this during the big spending bill at the close of the year. They were trying to stick it in there. We won that battle, kept it out. But now it's come out of committee. They're going to put on the floor this coming week. And I'm trying to rally America to say no to Monsanto and yes to citizens' right to know what's in their food.
So this is not, this measure that you're pushing for would not label food. It would just keep Monsanto from preventing people from labeling food.
Okay, two things. First of all, let's stop the DARK Act.
Okay.
All right. But I did put forward a different act that I think is completely fair. It's been endorsed by Ben and Jerry's. It's been endorsed, you know, that, with Ben and Jerry's, what other endorsement do you need than Ben and Jerry's? All right, but what it says is, okay, the companies are saying they don't want a different standard in a different state, and that's reasonable. So my bill says nothing on the front of the package, but on the ingredients panel, there will be either a symbol or a phrase which will tell everyone who wants to know if there's a transgenic or genetically engineered ingredients in the food. And then they can look up and find more information about it. Just label it's endorsed the bill. It's supported by Amy's Kitchen. That would be fair. Every one of us can go pick up the peas, look on the ingredients, just like you look for high fructose corn syrup or whatever else you're interested in, vitamins, so on and so forth. And you get the answer, you have the information you need, one standard, 50 states, fair deal. And so that's the alternative bill I'm putting forward.
Do you, this must be weird. I mean, this is probably normal for you. Most of my guests do not get an applause break for every sentence. This is interesting. My timing is a little off for it. When you write a bill, I was just curious about that, because you mentioned this is your bill. When you write a bill, and you know that bills, on average, don't get very far. When you write a bill, is it like a child that you've put into the world? Are you nurturing, or is it like, I've done it, I've done my best, on to the next thing? Like, how emotionally attached do you get from one of your own bills?
Well, I get pretty attached.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, because I feel like, in this case, for example, I brought in all the food companies, I brought in all the advocates, and tried to find the intersection so that we could have a bill that would do something useful in the world, give information consumers want, and fend off a very dark deed. Did I mention it's called the DARK Act?
You did. Okay. You're going to make that a thing. I think it's going to happen.
Because we have to rally the country over the weekend, because next Monday or Tuesday, the majority leader wants to put this DARK Act on the floor of the Senate. We don't have much time. So that's a challenge.
I just want to push back for just one second on this idea, because I'm personally unsold, I think, on this idea of labeling ingredients. Do you think that it's possible that saying, so, like, if you said, this product definitely doesn't contain applesauce, all of a sudden people would be like, is applesauce bad for me? What's the science on applesauce? Doesn't requiring a labeling of a thing imply the government thinks this is a bad thing?
Well, on that label are what vitamins are in the food. Obviously not a bad thing. How many calories, that's kind of neutral. Maybe it's good or bad, depending on if you want to gain weight or lose weight.
Right.
So and so forth. It's just information that consumers care about. For example, we require with fish, when it's sold in grocery stores, it has to be labeled whether it's caught wild or in a farm, because we care about it. So we ask the government to tell us so we can exercise our discretion. Juice, it says on the package whether it's from concentrate or it's fresh. Why? Because consumers care about it and we want to know. Well, consumers care about this. And here's the thing. The folks who are against this, who are against the labeling, they say, well, it's scientifically, there's no concerns of any kind about genetically engineered ingredients. And it's just not true. We are seeing weeds become resistant to herbicide because of the massive amounts of herbicides on Roundup Ready. We are seeing the western corn worm is becoming completely resistant to the pesticide that's been inserted into the roots genetically. We are seeing the impact on organic farmers because cross-crop contamination. And it even has an impact on the monarch. Do you like monarch butterflies?
We're for them? No, we're against them. Just some booing? Really ambivalent about these monarch butterflies here.
Okay, but in the Midwest, the herbicide has grown so exponentially, it's wiped out the milkweed the monarchs feed on. So the monarch population has come down dramatically over the last 20 years. And there is
some really weird opinions on butterflies, you guys. I think that one was a joke.
Beautiful thing. So there's scientifically documented benefits like vitamin A in rice that is needed somewhere in the world or something like that. But there's also scientifically documented concerns. That's why it should be up to the consumer, to the individual. They want to know. Let's let them know. They can make up their own mind. It's America.
Awesome. I need to let you go. I have so many things I want to ask. I could talk to you all day. Let's do this, but you are busy. I'm not busy, but you're busy. Let me just ask, does the craziness of the presidential election, does that filter down to you? Do you feel that in the Senate? Has it changed things?
Well, it does affect the Senate. We're missing a bunch of members, although fewer all the time. We started out, it seemed like a dozen people
right,
in the Senate.
Right.
The rest of us were standing around going, well, they're running. Why aren't we running?
You could have thrown your name in.
We watched those first debates and we all went, well, we could do better than that.
I think it's not too late to announce if you want to run in Iowa.
I think a little late, I think.
Okay.
I think a little late. Not this time around.
Not, ooh.
Late night action exclusive.
That cagey non-answer, we're breaking that here on stage.
Something might happen at some point.
Yeah, maybe not. Awesome. Well, best of luck on those issues, on getting rid of the dark bill this week. Where do people go if they care about this, especially the one that's happening this week for that?
Check out my website, senatormerkley.com.
They didn't give you one of those cool .gov sites?
Senate.merkley.gov. That's right. Thank you.
Oh, okay, cool. I bet senatormerkley.com is something weird. I bet that's not.
I'm glad you corrected that.
That seems like one of the best parts, is
also
getting the .gov.
Just Google the Dark Act, and it'll take you right into the conversation.
That's great. Check that out. Google the Dark Act. You guys, not now. It'll be very rude. Wait till the second half of the show. Ladies and gentlemen, Jeff Merkley.
Thank you very much.
I do feel like I could ask like 30 or 40 more questions. I only wrote 7 more, but I told him I was a lightweight, and then I was like, do I get to push back on this one thing? I don't want to break my promise of being a lightweight.
Your approval ratings plummeted, by the way. Everybody else.
Oddly, I'm still polling ahead of monarch butterflies. I don't know how that happened.
Seriously, you guys hate butterflies. The Caterpillar Council is here.
Wait.
They hate butterflies.
Do they?
Yeah, because we all hate ourselves.
You hate growing up.
Them. Yeah.
I feel like there was a weird way that we became like a melodrama where every new character introduced you had to take a stand on, either booing or clapping. Enter the corn beetle. And you guys were like, no, boo. We don't know.
Interesting stuff. I'm like politically moved.
You are?
Something. Yeah.
I feel like I should hang out in more bathrooms. To learn stuff.
That sounds like a 50s epithet for being gay.
Hanging out in bathrooms?
A gentleman who lingers in bathrooms.
I mean, they were so classy back then when
they
were super homophobic and weird. What you did when he said bathroom, you immediately perked up.
I've been watching the new season of House of Cards. I'm just burning through it. You guys know what I'm talking about. So you're like, bathroom, that's where the shit goes down, you know?
Yeah.
So to speak, right. Sorry.
That is literally where the shit does go down.
Sorry.
Thanks, Steven.
I know.
Click.
Super classy episode with a senator on it, by the way.
We were classy while we were talking to
Pretty
him.
Classy.
We held it together. I am glad, because there was some light booing and there was some cheering, and this is a much more a calmer crowd than when we had Representative Blumenauer on, where we had our protesters.
We had a protest when...
Were any of you here for the... A couple of you? We had a group of
people. Were any of you guys protesters that started coming to the show? That would be amazing.
That would be amazing. They did pay full price. That was important to me. Well, it was crazy because they did. It was the most Portland like passive aggressive protest because they wore shirts that were like no TPP, but then they wore like sweater vests over them. And so as soon as the congressman came up, they all stood up and just went like. And then they sat down and watched the rest of the show. It was like
so sweet, and they were great. They laughed. They had a nice time.
Yeah. It was very strange. A couple of them left when we got dirty, but most of them were just like, "This is the best protest I've ever gotten to do. This is way more fun than hanging from the bridge." It's before, but you get it. What's new with you, Bree?
Things were great, but I got to moderate the Bernie Trump rally. That is two comedians doing impressions of Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump at Revolution Hall this week. And they were so hilarious, but one thing that was so great about Portland couldn't not boo at the man who was doing an impression of Donald Trump. And the guys who were playing Trump, the guy came to me later and he's like, "This city is so insulated, they can't hear a fake opinion that doesn't gel with them."
That's funny.
It was really great. What's up with you?
I got to do a little TV this week. My episode of Portlandia aired on Thursday. I'm very excited.
What now? Remind the audience what part you played on Portlandia. What did the audition say when you had to go out?
Boring straight guy number two. Number two. They'd already cast their first choice, boring straight guy.
You're too spicy for the first straight guy.
Is that how that works?
Yeah.
You're like, let's put the spicy one second. It was it was very strange, but I talked a lot in it. I actually had a lot of me. I was wearing their clothes, but when they first, the wardrobe calls, because the show's made for like $40, and so the wardrobe called and they're like, "Can you provide some items?" And I was like, "Sure, yeah, what are you looking for?" And they described what I was wearing. Dead, like, exactly what I had on. I was like, "They're light khakis. You want darker khakis, or are these khakis okay?" And they were like, "They're fine." It was, I live boring straight guy all the time. It's also weird to be on a show that literally no one watches when it airs, but everyone watches on Netflix later.
Yeah.
So it was gotta be like, "Guys, I was on TV yesterday and again in like 4 months where you'll actually see it."
I look forward to watching it in July.
It was kind of fun. The episode is also, it's a little weird. I don't know if you watched the show. Real weird. No, you haven't?
I have watched it before, yeah.
Yeah, it was real weird, and I don't know if I like necessarily was agreed. I was playing, okay, turns out, it was an episode where the straight guy is not the hero. And I know that sounds weird, that a boring straight guy might not be the hero of a story. But I was not. I might have been a bad guy.
Wow.
Yeah. I may have convinced the feminist bookstore that they needed a younger, hotter spokesperson.
Oh.
I didn't write it. I didn't say, like, I would like to say only things I believe on this show. I was acting.
They're mad because you're the face of the patriarchal empire.
Okay, here's the problem. I just want to, I'm not saying you need to empathize with me, but the problem is that there are a lot of faces of the patriarchal empire, and so I'm not seeing much of that money. That's my point. We're
That's
spreading
why
it among
have
all.
To compete all the
exactly.
time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly, we're spread too thin. All right, are you ready for your next guest? You guys ready to bring our next guest?
I'm ready.
Very funny. He's been taking the comedy scene by storm this last year. Please welcome Mr. Robbie Pankow.
Hey gang, how's it going? That's tight to hear. Let's see. So recently it's brought to my attention that I don't have enough jokes or like literally any jokes about what I look like, which is super troubling to people because they love to know that you know. So I was like, all right, fuck it. You know, anything for the fans. So I wrote a few. First of all, I know what you guys are thinking. You're like, what is this guy, newly 28? Yeah, it's, nailed it. That's exactly my age. Also, I know if I sell weed to Blossom, but like, I just thought y'all had eyes. We have to talk about that kind of obvious bullshit, but that's on me. I put too much faith. It's cool that people still know what Blossom is. That's literally unexpected every time. And it gets like half the crowd, but it's enough. Should I update it to a more timely reference? Yeah, not gonna. Daddy does what he wants and calls himself Daddy sometimes. That's, sorry. It grosses me out too. See, I've been intimidating a man recently, which is new. It's a lot of fun. I don't get the chance very often. Basically what happens is like, when I take the bus home and then I walk like 15 minutes to my house after that. And then there's a second man who has like probably like a 16 minute walk to his house, because I just follow this motherfucker home every night. And he hates it. It's obvious he hates it, because like half of the walk he'll just sprint a little bit. And it makes me so happy, because I don't get to like weird dudes out that much. So it's like, thumbs up, time for me to shine. I don't know what I'm saying. And like, I was wondering, because I was like, I'm not that intimidating. Like, what is making this guy so uncomfortable? And then I realized that for like 6 months straight, I just wore a hat that said death on the back in huge letters and read a big ass book about Columbine every night on the bus. Because it was on the pals reading list. I'm not fucking looking for tips on school shootings. I'm not even old. I'm too old to shoot up schools. Good, missed that one by a little bit. I want to like Billy Madison like go back to school to be a school shooter. Is that? No. Okay. That was just a riff that popped in my head, and you fucking hated it. So that's on me. That'd be a good movie though. Just don't get it twisted. Let's see. My mom has a new boyfriend. Yes. Okay. Wow. No applause whatsoever. That's tight. No. Shut up. You ruined it already. You fucking had one chance and you didn't take it. Not coming to dinner. She's not here right now, so it's fine. She's not like bummed out, but I am gonna tell her later. So, yeah, you guys are cold as ice and you hate my mom. That's not anything I'm thrilled about. She does have a new boyfriend, which is cool for her. Super weird for me, because I had to meet the dude. And I just kind of thought me and my mom were at a point in our relationship we could just fuck whoever we wanted, didn't have to have dinner about it. But that's on me. I'm a bad son. It's just, the problem is, like, I don't know how to talk to, like, adult men. Like, older dudes are not comfortable for me. Like, this is not a look you get with, like, a strong male role model in the household so much. So I just never figured that out or learned what to do. Like, I know some comedians that are older dudes, but we just talk about, like, drugs and comedy, and that's fine. I know how to do that. I'm comfortable there. But, like, regular adult men, I just assume talk about, like, business, sports, and leaving forever, because that's pretty much my whole experience. Shut up, you silly gooses. Come on. Too empathetic. Calm down. But yeah, so like I was like, Cakes, I also call myself Cakes. Daddy and Cakes. There'll be a list later of just weird shit I call myself. We'll go over it. But yeah, I was like, Cakes, you're pretty nervous. How are you going to get over these fears of this man? And the answer was just to get super high and wear sunglasses the whole time. Like a weird Brett Easton Ellis character. And it worked like a charm, gang, because I found out really quickly that, like, he was way more nervous about me than I was about him the whole time, basically. Like, my fears and concerns were, like, how am I going to feign interest in this older man's life for a few hours? And his fears and concerns were, like, how am I going to make this almost 30-year-old weirdo with dyed hair like me enough I can maybe continue to fuck this lady and not die alone? It's not all about you all the time, gang. You got to let your ego go a little bit. Older men need love, too. Just let those dudes fuck your mom. It's fine. Quit being a dick about it. Grow up, America. That's my political stand. All right, bye. That's it.
Robbie Pankow, everybody. Don't go anywhere. Great job. Have a seat. Sit down. Also, please welcome out comedian and writer Mr. Anthony Lopez. Join us on the couch, Anthony. Anthony, Robbie, and Bree make up what we call panel action. So this is where we pick up a few stories that we talk about some stories that we missed in the monologue, some local news, but it being politics day, we're going to do a little late night action debate, a very casual debate. We got some questions from the audience, some very good ones, a mix of difficult and easy, I think, depends on what you know, we'll just kind of state your opinion, discuss it, not like formal debate. Also, Robbie, great job. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks.
Yeah.
New mic, okay.
Yeah. Your stepson, Robbie Pankow.
Yeah. Redheaded even.
Well, so let's start. Is that what they meant?
Yeah, like a redheaded.
A redheaded. Yeah.
You never dyed your stepchild's head red just to feel better about what was gonna happen.
Yeah.
So we're gonna start out. I have a few questions to get through, and I'm gonna mix them up a little bit. Let's start here. Very important subject for the 2016 election. Greg asks, "What's funnier, mom farts or grandma farts?" Anthony, where do you weigh in on this issue? Mom farts or grandma farts? Funnier, not stronger or better, or funnier specifically.
I'm gonna go with mom farts.
Yeah.
Because grandma, by the time I showed up, just didn't give a fuck.
She doesn't care.
There's nothing
at all
special about a grandma fart. That was just like a thing grandma did because, well, don't bring it up, Anthony. Yeah. So mom farts, you just don't expect.
Do you? So, but her not caring makes them less important. I think that's funnier. You think that's less funny?
I find anything with my mom, and like I have something over her, that's funny to me. It's nice. I have a weird dynamic with my mom.
You do. It sounds like you do. Robbie, what do you think? Mom or grandma?
I'm going to say, first of all, I don't care for this line of talk. It's a lot of filth, and I'm not here for that.
We had an actual senator on the show, and we're also doing this.
I like to show my respect to that senator. I apologize for these audience animals.
A debate can only be as silly as the real debates. We just hold a mirror up to society up here, right?
Donald Trump literally said that his penis was big on a debate.
He called Ted Cruz a pussy on stage once. He actually said he's a pussy. It's amazing.
I know. So calm down, Robbie, is what we're saying.
All right.
This is not near Trump levels.
Let's see. I'm probably going to go grandma.
Grandma?
Because this goes out later, huh? On the internet.
Your grandma hanging around on the internet
a lot? She watches a lot of fake TV on YouTube.
Your grandma's got a Google alert for you?
She drinks, I guess, is what I'm saying. I was going to say.
Oh, okay.
So, like, I just imagine her being real drunk and passing gas. I don't care for this. And it seems...
We'll talk about her drinking, but this gas thing is really inappropriate.
Yes, yeah.
Bree, what do you think? I know you're close to your Nana.
I love when older people start to just not give a shit about anything.
Totally.
And it's so beautiful. And the other day, I was in the English muffin aisle at Fred Meyer behind a very lovely couple that did not give a shit or letting it fly. And I... like turned around and there was another young person and we quietly shared a laughter celebration moment and then also sort of like a grieving for yep, we'll be there soon one day, and then walked away and I didn't get any English muffins, but
I was gonna say, for a fart story, you're really setting up the food part of this.
Yeah.
Also, Fred Meyer has a whole English muffin aisle.
Had one till these two old fucks came by, desk cropped it with some Monsanto products.
Alright. Doug wants to know, can homelessness be solved?
Oh, boy.
Bree, what do you think?
I think the mayor decided he was going to solve homelessness by letting homeless people do exactly what they've been doing for the last 10 years in the city,
right,
which is camping out. So how can it be solved? Well, they've spent a bunch, this is supposed to be a funny answer, they were spending money to build housing for the homeless. And that's it. That's what we're trying to do.
I have a serious answer, which is that Salt Lake City has done some really interesting things where they just give homeless people homes, and it's been very effective. It's amazing if you just build apartments and put them in it, really solves that problem. No, not a joke, it's a very effective
program.
So
that is actually real, but I want to give you the counterpoint of what a city like San Francisco does, which is you bring the goddamn Super Bowl to your city. Super Bowl City, giant party, put all the homeless people on bus, have a good time.
Wait, party bus. Your answer is party bus?
Party bus, you know what I'm saying? That's what they did in San Francisco.
With
the Super Bowl. They brought in the Super Bowl and they bust out everyone and they were like, this isn't weird, right?
Salt Lake City was like, we just need to give the homeless homes. And San Francisco was like, we need to give the homeless party buses. Because they want to do karaoke while they're moving.
Jello shots.
All right. Robbie, I'm going to have you start out the next question.
Okay.
Which former wrestler besides Jesse the Body Ventura is the best for politics today?
Probably Stone Cold.
I mean, I don't think...
Too much of a religious association with that 316 thing, you know?
That's true. Okay, The Rock, then.
The Rock, he's the people's champion. Yeah.
He could be the people's president.
He's the most... He has to be the people's president. Yeah. The most electrifying politician in all of
the
show
new Baywatch.
Business. Yeah.
Also ask, like, five... Cause, you know what? Not any number. Ask any number of people, like, if they like The Rock or not. They all do.
Yeah. How many... How do you guys feel about The Rock?
Yeah, it's like, honestly, like, it seems to come up a lot in politics right now. Like, how are you going to handle Putin? And we know how the fucking Rock is going to handle Putin. He's going to take him off the goddamn top turnbuckle and give him the people's elbow. You know what I'm saying? People's elbow for fucking freedom. That's how we're going to handle Putin.
Yeah, he fought an earthquake. Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. If he can take on Undertaker in Hell in a Cell, he can take on Putin at G12 or whatever it's called.
Bree, are UFOs actually just military test planes? Or are they an alien status thing?
What kind of alien question. Status thing?
Well, it's like, you know, like having a big house or like driving a Rolls or something.
Okay,
they're like,
wait.
Look, I have a spaceship. I can fly to your planet.
Wait, so the assertion...
I assume that's what Mark means.
The assertion is that aliens don't have UFOs except for like the LeBron James of aliens.
Yeah, you don't think the 99% of aliens are flying to Earth just to cruise around, scare a guy at a farm, and go home.
Right.
That is a 1% activity.
So UFOs are just like the Lambos of the sky.
Exactly.
They're showing off.
Yeah, I'm with that.
Yeah, you're right, you buy it. Anthony, should Edward Snowden be imprisoned? I said Anthony, but I appreciate the effort.
I saw the trailer for the new Oliver Stone film about Edward Snowden, and I think someone needs to go to jail for that.
So
the movie does not look very good.
If you can't get Oliver Stone in jail, Edward Snowden.
Yeah, I mean, I would settle, because I saw Alexander. Oliver Stone should go to jail. Or W. What is that guy even doing these days? I can't settle for him, yeah, I'll take Snowden.
He'll probably just get Oliver Stone.
Yeah.
Just frame him for some shit.
Yeah. I honestly bet Oliver Stone would be easier to get in prison right now than Edward Snowden.
He's in the country, right?
Yeah.
That's maybe doable more.
Bree, what would your theme song be, and what does that say about you?
My theme song?
Your theme song.
It's a song by Salt and Pepper that some of you guys might know. It was also the beginning of the movie To Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything, Julie Newmar. You guys seen that movie?
I don't think most people have heard of that movie.
It's where Patrick Swayze's in drag.
Yeah, John Leguizamo, Wesley Snipes.
And Wesley Great Snipes. Movie. And the beginning is a Salt and Pepper song called Body Beautiful, and that would be my theme song. And I think it says that I'm a beautiful queen who demands attention.
Robbie, you got a theme song, right?
Yeah, Can't Tell Me Nothing by Kanye West.
Nice. That's a strong move.
Yeah. Yeah, you never feel not cool when that's on.
Yeah, it's as cool.
Anthony, what is the ideal hand size to penis size ratio?
For like a politician, because it depends on like what they're trying to go for, right?
Yeah, I guess it depends on what job you have, what you're going to do with it, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, because you're trying to be like a politician or like a porn star or like a craftsman. You know, I want like a different hand to dick ratio.
Well, but so what's interesting is the ratio, it could be like they're both very small or they're both very big. Or it could be like, do you want one to be much bigger than the other? Also, do you measure penises and hands? Is it like a horse thing? How many hands tall is this? What do you think? Is it like 1-to-1 or like 2-to-1?
I think a 4-to-1 ratio is good. I'm not going to say which way. Because frankly, there's strong arguments for both.
Just as long as they're at least 4 times different. Let's start with Robbie. What country will you be defecting if Donald Trump wins the presidency? I thought for a second said, to what country will you be defecating, which is a very different question.
We've talked. I don't care for that kind of... talk.
You don't. Where are you going to go? What would be your place to run away to?
Probably Canada, because Drake's there.
Oh, shit. I thought you were going to say because it's close, but also Drake's there.
Yeah, like, I just, like, want to go where there's cool people, and, like, that's all I could think of.
Drake?
Drake's the only cool guy.
Bree, where are you going to go?
I'm going to South Africa to hang out with Yassine Bey. What's up?
Oh, that's true, too. Okay.
Anthony, where do you want to run away to?
I don't know. I like Tijuana a lot.
the country of Tijuana. Is Tijuana where you can really show off that 4-to-1 ratio?
Yeah.
There's a show for you. All right, we gotta go. Ladies and gentlemen, that's the panel. That's Anthony Lopez, Robbie Pankow, and of course, Bree Pruitt. Thank you guys so much for the questions. I'm gonna give away some prizes for these in the second half, so make sure you stick around. In fact, it is time for our intermission, so we're gonna be back in the second half. Coming up in the second half of the show, we've got mayoral candidate Bim Ditson, who's also the drummer for the band And. Also, we have musical guest The Minders, we have prizes, we have more banter, and of course, a nice chat with DJ Bobby D up in the God Thing. What?
Can they qualify for prizes by filling out their...
Yeah, if you want, if you didn't get a chance to ask a question, you can ask another question that we might be able to work into the show, or you can just, if you want to put your name and email address, we can put you into a drawing for these prizes. So you can still participate, fill those out, make sure they, just, you can put them nearby. Well, I'll have someone coming around to collect them. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I feel like I'm losing your trust right now. This young lady right here in the second row is like looking at me like I'm just like, I was having a good time and you're fucking it up. All right, you guys, intermission. We'll be back in a few minutes. Stick around. Take us into the break, DJ.
Bobby, we are back. Alex.
Yeah.
Did you guys have a good intermission?
You did? Good.
Make some noise if you're in a bar line right now.
Nice. We did it. We got through it.
Okay, good. I think they're just really focused on their beer, actually.
No, I think we... All right. Feel free to get beer. Anyway, it doesn't matter. You guys know how to do a show.
What are you drinking? Juice?
It's a Red Bull. And I was like, it's going to look like a beer. And people are going to think I'm drinking a beer. And then I was like, oh, that's not actually weird. People do that on stage all the time.
Beers, yeah.
It just feels weird for me. We were talking backstage about politics, and I want you to actually share the first part of that, at least.
Well, I get really scared when people talk to me about politics because I feel like, you know, I'm disillusioned, I disengage. But I felt like all that Merkley, I felt like he was pretty down to earth, and I could really actually follow. And he reminded me, as someone who's grown up in Portland, of like every Portland dad that I've ever encountered are like teachers from high school that are just really care about rivers or some nerdy thing, and that can help set up your computer or something, you know. Seems like a good guy.
He does. I, you know, he's got those jeans, so he's approachable and
outdoorsy.
Yeah. My wife helped canvas for him the first time he was running in 2008. I was very busy, but
so I feel you were too busy to canvas?
I feel some ownership. Like, we did this. We made that happen. I really enjoyed it. And we were saying, I feel dumb, too. And I did tell him, like, I'm a lightweight. When I'm not going to press you on things. But he did a great job of, like, making me feel included and, like, catching everybody up.
Yeah.
It's pretty good. Yeah.
Hooray.
He's also, like, he's a nerd, which I enjoy. He's a policy nerd, which makes it a lot easier. I thought, like, that could have been how, like, somebody could have... If he'd been talking about sports, I would have zoned. But he was like...
Well, you guys started with a baseball metaphor, and I was like, oh, my God, is this what it's going to be like?
What was our baseball metaphor?
Big leagues and little leagues.
Oh.
T-ball.
The majors and the minors. We did... I didn't realize we lost you that fast.
It just was a big red flag. I was like, all right, these white guys got to talk for a little bit in a language that they... It's like white guy dog sniffing each other's butts, you know, like baseball? Baseball. Cool, 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 cool.
I don't watch a lot of baseball. I've heard of the major leagues. So that's an easy one. Speaking of talking, I guess, you've got a new radio show that
yeah.
I want everyone to know about.
So
DJ Bobby D does a show on X-Ray FM, and Bree has just joined the X-Ray family.
Yes, I have. So I have a show starting, it's actually airing now, but it's starting live March 17th at Thursdays at 8 p.m., and the show is called Sex, Drugs, and Basketball, and it's about sex, drugs, and basketball, but mostly we're talking about sex and relationships. Marijuana, just legal weed, and the Portland Trailblazers. I don't really give a shit about heroin and the Golden State Warriors. I'm just talking about the things I care about, which are weed and the Trailblazers. So,
but any kind of sex?
All the sexes, yeah.
Okay,
all the sex. And you can call in. If you have questions, you can write us questions via email. We'll address those. Or you can call in and talk to us. And I think there's going to be prizes at some point. We're trying to send
nice.
People pizzas that call us.
Yeah, and then make them pay for them?
No,
like,
no.
Just
that would be so
as
funny.
A prank?
We got their number. Sweet. It's our scam.
That's fun.
Yeah, should be good.
Who else is on the show?
My co-host is Arthur Bradford, who's a book award winner. He's an Emmy nominated filmmaker. He's a Portland treasure. So we're really excited. Yeah.
Very cool. Thursdays, 8 o'clock, X-Ray FM on the web and on your radio.
Yeah.
Excellent. Let's bring out our next guest, you guys. He's the drummer for and he's also running for mayor of this city. Please welcome out Bim Ditson, everybody.
How about Senator Merkley?
Yeah.
Did you like that guy?
Oh, yeah.
Did you guys get to talk backstage at all?
Not really, no.
No.
Busy guy.
Yeah, he's very... Bim, tell us about yourself. So tell us, like, because you're very well known in the music scene here.
Yes.
So tell us, like, what is your origin story?
I started a business making chainmail jewelry when I was 9 years old.
When you were 9?
And I've been doing that for 16 years. I was at Saturday Market selling my stuff today. So that's sort of my...
How did it go today? Was it a good day?
Oh, it was terrible.
Oh, yeah. The weather sucked.
Yeah, it's all right.
Is this... I assume this is a sample that you're showing us here? You have some... Yeah. That's yours? Yeah. That's a Bim original?
It is.
It actually looks really cool. Like, that sounds mean. What I mean is... chainmail, I picture, like, big and bold. But that's, like... I don't really like the material. It's really interesting.
Yeah, it's cool.
Are you, like, by hand? Yeah. So you started that business at 9. Ran away from home with a bunch of chainmail on your back.
Yeah.
And then you've also been a musician.
Yeah, yeah. I've been playing drums since I was, like, a baby kid. My mom was a music therapist, so music was, like, part of what you did.
Is that a job we're all familiar with? A music therapist?
Yeah. She would work with, like, autistic kids and people with like different sort of social disabilities and help rehabilitate people through the use of music. And it's a really cool thing. It's there's not a whole lot of them, but I think it's something that is really interesting.
And what was the thing that happened last year? This is your first foray into politics. What was the thing that happened last year that made you decide to run for mayor?
I sort of just saw that there hadn't been and wasn't, sort there weren't any candidates that I saw that represented anything close to my ideals and my friend's ideals. And so I thought maybe it would be useful to run so that sort of like the creative working class of Portland would have a horse in the race. And so that we could, if nothing else, be a part of the conversation when we talk about the future of Portland, we can be talking about the things that I believe have traditionally made Portland great. And it's those regular working class artists and musicians who flocked here to do something that was important to them beyond their pocketbook, to do something that mattered in their heart rather than in their bank account. And I think that that sort of idea is not lost in Portland, but it is a little bit lost in the politics of Portland, and I'd like to bring it back into the conversation.
Yeah. I saw you at this debate a couple weeks ago at Rev Hall, and An official mayoral, well, it was the one, I don't know if you guys remember this, that was going to be two people, and then there was a protest, and then the Oregonian backed out, and then it was everybody. Do you guys remember this story? The Oregonian said it was for safety, and what happened was the protesters had threatened to U-lock the doors closed, which is like scary, but also a very Portland way to terrorize people. And I don't think it's very serious, because those are like $80 a piece. There's no way. That place has a lot of doors. You're not going to waste that many U-locks. Anyway, so they opened the debate up. Everybody came in, and you killed it. You were great. And you found out at like 2 o'clock that day that you got to be in the debate. How did that go for you? How did that feel for you?
It was great. I mean, it felt right, you know? It felt like something where we were going to have a discussion between two extremely similar career politicians that I don't think are representative of regular Portlanders. They're completely out of the tax bracket of Portlanders, and
yeah,
one of them spends all their time in Salem. But it was going to be sort of a boring conversation, and I think instead we had a really exciting conversation, and I think that
the other, you know, myself and the other five candidates that were able to make it that otherwise wouldn't have been on that stage. It was really cool to hear from all of them. I think that there's a lot of agreement between everybody who's running about a lot of stuff, and I think that's the thing to focus on when we think about why it's important to have diverse conversations is not so that we can focus on our differences, but so that we can focus in on what makes us the same and what is really important to everyone. And if we have eight candidates speaking to the same side of a thing, it's way more impactful than we have two candidates. So I think that's the key thing, is remembering it's an issue of positivity, not an issue of like getting a whole bunch of jokers on stage and fighting about stuff.
Well, so what, I definitely saw a lot of that agreement. I think that is a very good point. What's something from the agreement you guys all, like, you thought the whole swath of candidates agreed on that you really care about?
Well, that's harder.
Okay. You wanted, we could do a disagreement. That was what I was going to ask. Yeah, and then you were so positive, I couldn't be like, screw that.
Well,
let's hear you say something bad about Jules.
Let's do yours.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, tell me about the disagreement. I watched the whole, like, the two-hour debate, and I do not remember a disagreement that was very large. With the one thing I remember is that you definitely disagreed with the two frontrunners about how much money one should raise in order to run for mayor. Oddly, they thought it was a high number, and everyone else was not so into that. We'll start there, then. Like, how do you think the financing of this election is affecting it?
Yeah, I think that, you know, in Portland, it's the same as all over the nation right now, and it's just an issue of, are we as a democracy going to allow money to be more important than human beings or not? And if we elect people who run campaigns that are reliant more on money than they are reliant on their ideals and their convictions that draw voters to them, then we're choosing corporations over people. We're choosing all the things that will happen are going to lead back to that. I mean, I guess the simple way to think of it is, if you're voting for somebody, figure out how many dollars they have and how many of those dollars lead back to Portlanders and how many of those dollars don't lead back to Portlanders, and then you can see what they're going to do in office. That's just how it works. So for me, it's an extremely important issue. And it ties back to really key things, like, for me, one of the main things that I would like to do in Portland is run a feasibility study on a public bank. I think it's probably the most important thing that we could do, and it's gotten no traction from any career politicians. It's ridiculous. It's a way that we can keep our tax dollars out of Wall Street's hands and keep our investment in those dollars and our leveraging of those dollars going back into our region.
I'm gonna say those are like the six people who are much smarter than me about what that actually. So I was gonna ask you to clarify, what is a public bank?
Is this an idea that's been kicking around, or is this fairly new?
This is, okay, so there's one public bank that functions this way in America, and it's been around for 96 years. It's the Bank of North Dakota. It's arguably the most stable bank in the history of the United States. It has led to the communities that bank with it and the city governments that bank with it were the only communities, the only cities that didn't see impacts in a negative way from the financial crash that happened. It's clear that a public bank is the best way to safely protect citizens' tax dollars. So to that end, it then becomes scary when we have a mayoral candidate who's raised $500,000 who was a senior advisor at Bank of America before he was a politician.
Right.
That's scary to me.
So I was pausing for applause, didn't happen. Now I'm just way thrown off. Just don't understand you guys.
I'm no Merkley.
So
I was gonna say, you look like comedian Robbie Pankow, but you sound a little bit like Jeff Merkley.
Well, so that actually,
mashup.
I do want to hear more. So I want to give you the same opportunity I did with Merkley to say three things you care about. That could be one or not. You can start over. But first, I do want to talk about the thing that Bree just said, because one of the things that happened at this debate was I was sitting near some old people, and they loved you. They loved you. And I wouldn't say they planned on loving you. I feel like every time you would talk, they would go, oh, this guy, yeah. Have you gotten that reaction to people? Are people surprised that you know so much about this? Like, do you think people treated you differently than they did when other candidates got into the race? And have you surprised those people?
Yeah, I think I surprised people. And, I mean, we all, you know, making judgments about other people is part of how we evolved. And I don't blame anybody for doing it. But I do appreciate how much in Portland people really are willing to listen to someone and change their mind. I think that's one of the big strengths of anyone who is smart.
Yeah.
Is the willingness to be wrong.
Yeah.
That's what intelligence is.
Yeah. I thought that was so cool. And I think some people may have judged when the debate first started that they thought you were going to be more like the candidate who just yelled fuck you at the audience a bunch of times. I don't remember his name. He did not do great.
I like it. Sounds like he's kind of an outsider. I like him.
It was like the second time he talked, people started booing him, and he was like, fuck you, I don't need you guys. And I was like, I think you do, man. I think you do. That's mostly how democracy works, yeah. So, but have you been, when you talk to people, are they surprised? Are they on board with you? Or are you even getting the opportunities to talk to people as much? Because that was the biggest debate at that point. I think it was the first time you guys had all gotten together at that point.
Yeah, you know, I think people are surprised for like 10 seconds and then either they don't care about politics or they're down. You know?
That's amazing. You win people, like being consistently winning people over in 10 seconds. That's very, you'd be very proud.
I'm very good.
Yeah.
I want to hear your three.
Yeah, I want to hear your three things. So you can count the public bank or you can and start at two, or you can start over at one if you have three things. But what are things that people should care more about than you think they do?
Or things that they don't understand maybe necessarily.
Sure.
Like we were talking about.
Yeah.
I think one thing that's really important in relation to, you know, affordable housing and the housing crisis is like the big thing in this debate. And I feel like the focus should shift from being about there's a lot of people moving to Portland. Oh, no. It shouldn't be about that because cities can deal with that. It should more be about a lot of people came to Portland and why didn't the elected officials do the stuff that makes that work. Why do we have a housing crisis? We shouldn't have that. We have a surplus budget this last year of $49 million. It's not like the city doesn't have the means to do stuff. My argument is that when cities grow like this, it's often seen as an opportunity for a lot of outside interests to make a lot of money. And usually, when you chase money, you don't land at morality. So that's the thing I would like to bring up is let's think about, you know, different sort of like commissions that are in place that are supposed to deal with this stuff. Look at the PDC. Why does it look like when you look at the people who are serving on the PDC, it looks like a convention for developers. Why do we have developers drawing the maps for this? We should have community leaders drawing the maps for this.
I think the Development Commission looks like that because that's literally what it is. Yeah. I think you have a very good eye for developers.
A bunch of hard hats and stuff? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. But the suits and the hard hats, because they're not working there. They just don't want something to fall on their nice suit. Awesome. So number two. Give us number two. Or number three. Did you count the other one? This is important for my scorekeeping.
I don't know.
Okay, decide later. So,
what do you think?
Do you think
you learned enough about public banking to care?
Well, it's something that I've not heard of. I know you mentioned at the debate, and I like made a mental note to look into it, and I didn't. And it sounded like the other candidates had not spent a lot of time thinking about this public bank idea either. So I'm super curious about this, especially given that like I think like right now one of the candidates in the national race gathering a lot of attention is talking almost exclusively about banks. And I haven't heard that from that group either. So I think I'm fascinated by that idea.
Yeah.
So I would count that. Do you guys want to count that? Yeah. But I also do want to talk to you more about homelessness because we were talking about that backstage. There's so many issues I want to hear from. So, but give me number two that you think we're not caring about enough.
Definitely tackling homelessness.
Okay, great. Tell us about that. So we were talking backstage really briefly, and I wanted to hear your thoughts on how we handled that earlier and what you think about it.
You had mentioned what happened in Salt Lake City and sort of like their program of how they just, basically what they did is they, as a city, gained access to a whole bunch of housing stock. And they took that and they decided the way to gain most on every level is is to give people who don't have access to a place to live access to a place to live. And it worked.
Yeah.
Which is makes perfect sense, actually.
Yeah, it sounded like a joke when I said it, but it actually worked.
Yeah.
It was a thing that happened.
Yeah, and the idea, basically the idea behind that is that, yes, it's a big investment to do that, and it seems like a huge pile of money to dump into this place to basically buy up a bunch of places for people to live.
Right. It's also more expensive here than Salt Lake, where nobody wants to live.
Yeah, yeah. And that's that's totally a challenge. But the thing I'd like to get to about that is that what you're basically, if you want to look at it from an economic standpoint and you want to make an economic argument for solving homelessness, it's the best thing that you can do with any demographic is take somebody who is costing the city a ton of money because we're being forced to treat them like criminals and police these people who need help, and it's very expensive with all sorts of healthcare stuff, that stuff. It's super expensive. So you take something that was a cost to the city and you turn it into somebody who has stable work, who's in a situation where they're renting, and that becomes a huge benefit. So it's sort of like it's the most improved players of a city if we want to get to sports.
Yeah.
And
Bree's not even, she's just so gone. She was like, she was already, you lost her. So is that something you think is feasible here? You think that's something we could make happen?
Yeah, what I would propose is that for the short term, yes, we need shelters for everyone. We need to get people off of the street. It's a life and death situation. We have to do that, period.
Yeah.
In those shelters, I would propose that we also offer at least 20% of the number of beds that they house per night in subsidized transitional short-term housing for people who go to those shelters, so that somebody who's homeless can go to a shelter, discover a way to start climbing out of their situation, access it at that location, and then move into affordable housing.
Yeah, I guess right.
We can't, the shelter thing is super important, but let's not let it distract us from the end goal. The goal is getting people permanently off the streets. If we don't have a bridge between shelters and permanent housing, then you're going to just continue to have homeless people continue to have a system that they're trapped in rather than one that they can get out of.
So you've got what sounds like a very good plan for that. I agree with you about the Development Commission. I agree with you about the public bank, I think, pending more research. Do you feel like now, but these are also not, this is not the way that the front runners in this race are talking. So how is your experience of running against that? How is the campaign going? How are you going to bring this to people? How is this going to work in terms of a campaign?
I'm here.
It's a good start. Good start. And you're here because at the debate you were amazing. And so I feel like this is like when people see you, they want to hear more from you. So that's a good start.
Yeah.
But you are like, I don't know what, like $750,000 behind, I think, with Wheeler on his fundraising. You're a little behind.
Yeah, I think, but I think that that's, you know, when it comes down to it, I'm glad to be the worst fundraiser as a politician. You know, like.
Yeah. Yeah.
I see that as a positive. You know, for me, it's like that's 750,000 strings that I won't drag into City Hall.
Well, the snarky part of me wants to say that it's hard to get into the City Hall without string. Like that, the strings are also what pull you into City Hall. Does that sound like? I agree with you, but I also think that I'm very cynical. I think the world we live in might make that hard. So can you climb out of that hole? Can you make that work without the strings? Great. So where do people find out more? Where can they, where do we take the fight from here?
You can go to bimformayor.com.
Four or four?
We bought both.
You are so smart. Self-funded both of those domains. You were so ready for that question.
Yeah.
All right, so we go to bimformayor.com.
Yeah, so basically the way that the campaign is built is that we don't really have anything that we do with money. We don't have a... If somehow we got a ton of money, mm-hmm. we're structured in a way where we would have to just give it to charity. We don't have any way of spending money. So what we did instead is invested a whole lot of time figuring out how can we give people something that they can do with autonomy to be active in their local climate, to affect their neighbors, to get their like buddy who's sleeping on their couch to register to vote, to do any of that stuff. Yeah. And so what it is, basically, you go to the website and you make an account, and then it has a whole bunch of tasks and you do stuff. And that's how democracy works.
Very cool. BIM4Mayor.com. Listen to Mr. Bim Ditson. Now, you guys, as they finish setting up for the band, I just want to say we have amazing local DJ Bobby D up in the booth. You see DJ Bobby D up there?
Hey.
You look so cool in the booth, Bobby.
It feels good.
Yeah. So we're doing a thing now. I've been asking you some DJ questions. You're teaching me about the art of DJing.
Okay.
And I had a question for you. I was wondering. So you got your vinyl up there tonight. You're spinning. So most of us have phones with our music on it now. Why do you still bring the tables? And are those real or are those just spinning blanks and then you're playing MP3s?
Combination of both, actually.
Ooh.
Full of sneak attack. Yeah, sometimes you can do a little hybrid thing, incorporate turntables with Serato or Tractor, all these new development programs where you are spinning MP3s. But I like the vinyl because I like the workout. It's like having a bowling ball that you bring to the bowling alley. I just like to have the vinyl.
That's why they do it, is for the workout. They're not better. There's no way that helps.
They depreciate in value every time you spend them.
Are you able to scratch that vinyl, or is that really expensive, great records, so you wouldn't want to mess it up?
It depends. You know, I'm down to scratch up a good record if it's worth it.
Oh, nice. It does ruin it, though? I assumed it does.
Oh, it does over time, yes.
Could you bring, like, a thing that's nothing, play an MP3, and then go scratch, scratch, scratch on the nothing?
Of course you can. Yeah. People do it all the time.
Really? They just have, like, a record that doesn't play music that's just for scratching.
Exactly. It's called a blank.
That's a great name for it. That's what I would call it, too.
Common practice.
If you are hanging out with DJs and they're like, I bring blanks, do you look down on them? Is there like a hierarchy of the...
No, it's just sort of like, I mean, in hip-hop culture, a lot of people, you know, you'll bring your beats or the thing that you're going to scratch over your actual track. So it's like, it's less functional. You know, it's basically white noise as compared to the actual beat juggle.
You also are like playing a lot of originals up there. I can tell some of those cool.
So there are limitations to bringing only vinyl in that you.
Do you just look directly into that one? Don't look at it.
I'm trying not to.
Why you did it again? You're an audio guy, not a visual.
There's limitations in doing the vinyl, and basically it's just that, if you want to get one of your tracks pressed, you've got to go through all the motions to get it onto wax.
Right. So if you write your own music, you can put it on your phone today, or you can put it on a record in a month.
Totally.
Yeah. Your radio show is Friday nights.
On X-Ray, it's called Night School. It's a modern soul boogie and outsider funk. X-Ray is 107.1 FM. And Bree's got a show on Thursdays at the same time.
Oh, she's the third, and you're the Friday both at 8. You're
eight. Oh, you're 8. Okay, I'm 6.
You're 6. Okay, sorry.
It's new. It's hot off the press.
I got confused. And you play that funk. When you play on the radio, are you playing vinyl or are you playing fake vinyl?
It's actually all vinyl.
Oh, cool.
I make a point to do that.
Because like, if you were faking, we would have no idea. It's a radio show.
It's totally true, yeah. But I'm a purist in that way. I keep it on wax for radio.
I love it. Are you guys ready? How you doing?
Thanks, guys.
DJ Bobby D, everybody. Give him a hand. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our musical guest, The Minders.
Waves that over whitewashed piers.
Originally started 20 years ago, or 21 years ago in Denver, and we have been part of this musical collective. Maybe some of you have heard of the Elephant Six Recording Company. It's a psychedelic DIY, you know, lo-fi recording collective, and we've evolved over the years and just continue to do it, and we're getting ready to put out a record this year. It's our first release in 10 years. And,
Yeah, 21 years around, you got a new record. How is that, how does it sound compared to when you put out your last record?
It's much different. We had a gentleman by the name of Larry Crane of Jackpot.
A guy, Larry Crane.
Record. We've done some work with him in the past, but in this particular venture, we let him take over and produce us and recorded us, and so as Portland Cello Project's on it. A whole bunch of local musicians are on it. And
very cool. What's it called? Where do we find it?
It's called Into the River, which is the track we just played. It will be coming out in September. We're self-releasing it. Part of kind of why it took so long to put out, because we had to raise the money. You know, we had to do a Kickstarter and all that stuff. And so it's taken a while to.
And you've also got a booth in the back. You're saying to people, what have you got back there?
Well, we have T-shirts and coupons. Download coupons and 45s and you know, CDs and stuff. But
are they real 45s, or are they just blanks and then
no,
you get the
MP3? No, they're real. They're real, yeah.
Awesome. Will you play us one more song?
You bet.
The Minders, everybody!
Thank you.
Goddamn cheerful. I like it a lot. Ladies and gentlemen, that's it for our show. We're going to be back here again April 9th, second Saturday again. We'll be back. Please come back and see us again. A big thank you before we go to everybody at Mississippi Studios, especially Zoe and Boone. Boone just got named one of the best new bands in Portland by the Willamette Week. Give Boone a hand. We really appreciate it. Also, our stage manager, Heather DeWig, writers Anthony Lopez and Stephen Wilbur from L.A., guest writer Zach Toscani, and of course, the amazing Bree Pruitt. Go to latenightaction.com to find out more, see video of our previous guests, and to find out about our next show, please come back and see us again sometime. Have a good night, you guys.